A very good morning to one and all present here. My name is Ankita Rathore, student manager of Balaji Institute of Telecom and Management. Is privileged to introduce Mr. Prabhash Nirbhay, sir, founder and CEO of Flipcarbon Integrated Solutions Pvt. Limited. Sir, previously was a head HR in operations at Submiller India. In January 2015, sir has started a new journey with brand communication and vision anchoring venture called Flipcarbon Integrated Solutions Pvt. Limited. Prabhash sir has started his career in cement from ACC Limited and having subsequently worked across fashion, retail, food and beverages sector in companies like Vanity Fair, Irwin Brand and Submiller India. Sir is an accomplished and result-driven HR professional with consistent career record of more than 15 years in all aspects of HR. Sir is a postgraduate in HR with various awards to his name like NIPM Gold Medal, Sir Ratan Tata Trust Scholarship, Submiller Best HR Strategies and so on. Sir has published various articles like Gender Diversity in Human Capital magazines, How Humans Are Human Core in Core Communique, and It's Time to Bust the HR Myth in People Matter magazine. Sir is currently consulting many of the top giants like Submiller India, Relaxo, Jayanti Group, VIP Industries, Seat, and Reliance Brands. Sir is a subject matter expert on employee engagement with more than 10 years of experience in handling employee engagement surveys. Sir has conceptualized, designed, and run assessment centers. Now, I would like to invite Mr. Prabhash sir on the dais and request him to address the gathering. Sir, the dais is all yours. Thank you.
I heard a lot spoken about myself, so let me first introduce myself in the real sense. So my name is Prabhash Nirbhay. I like to call myself a founder and a wannabe CEO. Yeah, not really a CEO, because I genuinely believe that to be a CEO, you need to have something of scale to your name. Before you do that, you are just a wannabe CEO. You know, startups is a very, very glamorous profession today. People talk about startups as if they have arrived in their lives. They haven't. No. By the time you arrive in your life as a founder, you are no more a startup. That's the reality. In fact, I like to tell people that running a startup is like reproduction in reverse. You have a lot of labor pains for a long period of time before you can experience an orgasm. That's how startups are. So, any startup founder who stands here and says that, look, we are doing great work, is lying. Because if he's already doing great work, then it's no more a startup. It has reached a scale and it is now a proper company. And that is when I would like to remove that word wannabe from my profile. Because then I would no more be a wannabe CEO. I'll be an actual CEO, which is not what I am today. In fact, after 15 years of my career, I reset my career. And I'm just like you guys. Today, there is no difference between you and me. Today, I am same as you, a struggling professional. A professional who must burn the midnight oil to deliver something of value to someone who needs that value. If you don't do that, you are going to be a nobody. So today, I am standing here as a student of the HR function. Same as some of you who might be from BIM HRD here. So that is who I am in reality. So we stand here to talk about the future, right? What is your topic? One person, what is your topic? Futuristic trends and challenges in B-School. So I'm sure you would have so far listened to about 7 or 8 speakers talking about this topic. Yeah? And tell me one thing. What percentage of that was original content? And after what session it starts becoming repetitive for you guys? Be honest about it. sorry? After three sessions, is it? So after three sessions, the content becomes repeated. Because as soon as you talk future, and I am able to protect it, if I am able to predict what is the future, then it's not the future, right? Then it's the current. If you are able to predict it, it has already arrived here. Because if it has not arrived, you will find it extremely difficult to predict it. So whatever people talk about the future is, let's talk about the future. No, we can't talk about the future. We can talk about the fallacies of the future. You know, future is an excuse. Future is actually an excuse to not do good content, good quality work at this moment. That is what future is. Because the future is actually a sum total of what you did yesterday and what is it that you are going to be doing here today. That is all that is to the future. Future is actually not something which is going to arrive because it has already been set in a particular direction. Future is actually something which you will set in motion by your actions today. So whatever you call the future hasn't yet been decided. Because your future will be decided by what you decide to do at this moment, right now. If you can get 60 seconds worth of good quality work, good quality effort out of yourself today, this moment, you would have designed a future for yourself. Actually, that is what a future is. So when you say future trends, decide, what do you want to be a future trend? Do you want a future trend to be a future of a greater divide between a CEO salary and the first line manager salary? Or do you want it to be a more equitable future? Do you want it to be a future where some of us get to study in convent schools, whereas some of us struggle in schools where even the teachers don't exist? Or do you want a future where we have more equitable growth for all of us, all 7 billion people in this world? Which future do you want? Whatever future you want, you can set a course for that future today. That is why my topic is going to be called Carpe Diem. Seize the moment. Let's not talk about the future. Let's talk about today. Let's talk about what you are going to be doing now. Next 1 hour, what is going to be your takeaway from this session? Because if you haven't planned a takeaway from this session, plan it now. And if you can't plan it, then it's 3,600 seconds of wastage. Don't do that. So Carpe Diem, seize the moment. That is what I'm going to be talking to you guys about today. So in 1927, in the American Collegiate School of Business lecture, Professor Alfred North Whitehead stood up to say something. And it was 1927, 90 years back. I don't know why, but 90 years later, his words are as true today as they were then. And he said, "Imagination is not to be divorced from the facts. It is a way of eliminating the facts. The tragedy of the world is that those like you who are imaginative have but very little experience, and those who have experience have very little imagination." So whatever people talk to you about the future, trust me, it's not the future, it's the past. You hear words like Internet of Things, you hear words like digital, you hear words like VUCA, and a lot of words, the jargons. Now, my submission to you is whenever somebody throws a jargon at you, ask them exactly what it means. And you'll realize that for a lot of us, it has just become that jargon. The jargon is an end in itself. The jargon is not doing anything to help us progress further. The jargon is not the world, guys. The jargon is there to hide behind so that we can say that, look, now that it is a VUCA world, what do you want me to do? So what you do is there are four words: volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous. Four very, very different things. You combine all of them together call it VUCA and say, now what do I do? I can't do anything because it is VUCA. I can't do anything because it is too complex. I can't do anything because it is too ambiguous. I can't do anything because it is too uncertain. This is not how it is. Actually, the world is a very simple place. We tend to make it complex. All of us tend to make the world a complex place. It is not at all complex. It is very, very simple. It is not at all volatile. It is very, very simple. All the volatility in the world is in our imagination. You know, I'll show you certain things which you'll say, what are we talking about for the last 100 years? 1995. Any special significance for any one of you for 1995? Sorry, I can't hear you. So how many people in this room were born in 1995? Raise your hand. Okay, keep it like that. How many were born in 1994? 1995, keep your hands up, no problem. 1996? No, keep your hands up. So 94, 95, 96. Anyone from 93 here? 92? Great. So, 90. You are from my generation, mate. '89? Come, join me. come here. It's okay. So you know what is 1995? Any guesses what is 1995? What is 1995? Gen X, Gen Z, actually I am Gen X, 1979, Gen X. You guys are actually what they call Gen Z or the millennials. Okay? Now here's the funny thing. In 2008, somebody decided that anyone who was born around 1995 will be called a millennial. Okay? And then they said that, look, if you are a millennial, you are going to be very, very different from the rest of the ordinary mortals. You guys are special. You are God's gift to mankind. So somebody decided that. And then they said, look, because these guys are millennials, they want something different in life. You know? Now look at the funny thing. Today I'm standing here, and you are sitting there, and I look more of a millennial than you guys look. Isn't it? So actually every human being is unique. You know, there's nothing special about being born in 1995. All of us, since the year 60,000 BCE, when human beings started speaking, we are all unique people. And our uniqueness is something to be celebrated, but our collaboration is something to be strived for. But you will keep hearing a lot of these things. Now, here is the funny bit, and I'll tell you. So this is how typical definition of generations is, right? 28-44 is traditionalist, then baby boomers, 1945 to 64. Then my generation, Generation X, I was on the outer limit of Generation X, 1979. Then they started talking about Generation Y, 1980 to 1994. And finally they came to you guys, the Gen Z people or the millennials. Okay? And then for the last, as you can see, 28 to now is 90 years. For the last 90 years, medias and management thinkers are trying to fool us into believing that we are different from somebody else. Of course we are. Our being different is nothing unique. That has been true for generation after generation after generation after generation. What is important is not that we are different. What is important is how can we carry all of these differences together. This is not the time to separate people into compartments. This is actually the time to integrate people even more. This is the time when you say, look, I know you are different from me, but how can we work together? Because today, there are practically four generations in the workplace, right? Can you afford to be different from the others? And is that difference good or bad for organizations? That is the important part. So if you look at it, now I'll show you something which is extremely funny. Extremely funny. Life magazine talked about the generation gap. Okay? Then in 1976, New Yorker says this is the me decade. People of this generation are all about themselves. They are too full of themselves. They don't think about the society at large. 1990, they said 20-somethings are lost. That was again Time magazine. 1996, they talked about the golden geeks, you know? People who are connected, people who are tech savvy, people who are who can do things with computers. Then 2013 Time magazine went back to saying what New Yorker was saying in 1976. This generation is the me generation. They are too selfish. They are only full of themselves. And then in 2015, they are again talking about millennials. Don't get carried away by the media hype. Every 10 years, they will come up with something new to justify the 20-year-olds of that generation and tell the world how these guys are going to be different and they're going to be changing the world, of course. The age of 20 is the age to change the world. At the age of 23, Bhagat Singh was hanged for believing in something, right? So the years from 19, when you are 20-year-old to when you are 30-year-old, that is going to come in the life of every single human being. That is the most productive year of your life. You are going to be the most productive. There's nothing unique about it. VUCA. What is VUCA? One person. I want one person to put his or her neck on the line. What is VUCA? Great. Now come and explain all the four words to the people here. Come, take a mic. Okay, no problem.
Hello?
Yeah.
Volatility means everything, like it's not stable. That means it's volatile. Uncertain is we cannot predict it. Complex is we cannot understand it. And ambiguity is we are confused about it.
Great. So these are four different concepts, right? These are all four different concepts. And the easiest way to not do anything about it is to take all these four different concepts, combine it into one acronym, and now say that, look, the world is a VUCA world, I can't do much about it. Now imagine the first sailors, you know, the first people who decided to set sail. And the first time people decided to set sail, people did not know whether the world is flat, like this, or round, like this. Which means they had no way of knowing whether they are going to fall off the edge of the world or continue their journey. You think today's world is more volatile than then, more uncertain than then, more complex than then, and more ambiguous than then? Imagine John F. Kennedy, Robert Kennedy, Martin Luther King Jr., three people who together tried to change the world, right, around the same time. When you decide that two human beings are born equal, they must live equal, at a time when your entire country is divided into two halves, you think something can be more volatile than that? So the world has always been volatile. It's not like the world has turned volatile today. The world has always been uncertain. It is not like it has turned uncertain today. The world has always been complex. It's not that it has turned complex today. And the world has always been ambiguous. It is not that it has turned complex today. In fact, the very fact that a GPS can tell you the route to the nearest toilet today makes today's world a lot less volatile than then, when it didn't know the route to Americas, right? So a lot of these are objects to hide behind and say that, look, I can't do anything now. These are not real problems of the real world. And here is a little something to tell you what I exactly feel about VUCA. Take a moment to read it. Yeah. And then interestingly, I'll tell you what Ronald Reagan thought about the entire thing. They say that the world has become too complex for simple answers. They say that the world has become too complex for simple answers. They are wrong. They are wrong. What succeeds is actually simple answers. Learn all the complexities you want to learn here for your 2 years journey here. When you go back to business, simplify. You know, mankind has come a long way. We all started from an apple, and we are still at an apple. So that is the reality of mankind, actually. From the first day when Adam and Eve decided to eat that apple and said that, look, now we know about the truth about ourselves, we are still there. Human beings fundamentally are of the same nature. They haven't changed much. So, no, you keep hearing these things. No, the world's largest taxi operator has no taxis. Correct? The world's largest taxi operator has no taxis. The world's largest hotel has no real estate. So what? The world's largest bars never owned a brewery. In fact, they did not own a furniture manufacturing facility also. Outsourcing has been a reality of life always. It is not something which has happened today. So what are we worried about? What is it that we are complaining about? The world will change. It is supposed to change. It has always changed. There's nothing new about that. So we will always decide what do we want to do ourselves and what is it that we want to outsource. So today, Uber had decided that they will outsource their taxis. So what? Long back, the bar owners decided that they will outsource their alcohol manufacturing. They did. Then they decided they will outsource their music. They did that too. So everybody is going to be talking about outsourcing something which they don't want to handle on their own. There's nothing new that is happening today. Yes, digital interface and the cheapness of data, the fact that data has become so cheap, is accelerating the process. That is about it all. So yes, data has become cheap. Mobile phones have become dirt cheap. Connectivity has become easier. Wireless connectivity is almost there all around us. So instant connectivity has become easier. I was just talking to your media team just before I entered this hall. And whatever the last speaker said is possibly already on your Facebook page. You may have already tweeted about it. Yes, that is a reality. But then, decade after decade, the world creates new realities for itself. And those realities shape our future. But the shape of the future is decided by what we do today. Internet of Things. Any idea when the internet was born? So all of us know about the Internet of Things, right? But none of us know when the Internet was born. 1980. So TCP, ICP, IP came in 1980, and HTTP came in 1991. And when the two married, that is when the Internet was born. The first website, the CERN website, was in 1991. So it is not like IoT has happened suddenly today. It has been in under development since 1980. So all that we talk about as if it is our bright new future is actually a consequence of a lot of effort in the past. And that is the important thing to remember. Yes, Internet of Things is going to make life easier. But no, it is not the future. It is actually what we are doing now at this moment. So we must understand that a lot of these nice sounding jargons and a lot of these nice sounding words, the effort behind that actually takes decades to happen. But the efforts take 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, 40 years, 50 years before it actually becomes a reality. So actually your future is hugely dependent on your past and your present. So what you do now will have a huge bearing on what happens in the future. So I would like my mobile phone to talk to my refrigerator, of course, makes my life easier. But what it does after that, and whether it fundamentally changes the way human beings eat, will decide whether it was important enough to consider. Because the fact of the matter is, in a world where about 20 crore people go hungry every day, talking about your refrigerator, talking to your mobile phone isn't the biggest problem to solve. It is not really the biggest problem to solve, ladies and gentlemen. And I think we should concentrate our energies on the right problems to solve, not just the glamorous problem to solve. So I think the focus should be on solving the right problems, not the glamorous problems. Yes, let my telephone order groceries for my refrigerator, but let us for a moment think about the people who neither have groceries, nor refrigerators, nor telephones. And I think that is where you will bring real change. So if you want to talk about the challenges of the future, talk about the challenges of the present. Talk about the people who don't get one single meal a day. Talk about the people who survive on less than 20 rupees a day. Talk about the people for whom the definition of poverty line, 37 rupees, itself is a joke. What do you get for 37 rupees? You want to solve problems of the future? You want to talk about the B-school challenges of the future? Here, I give you your challenge. For the last 3 years, government of Karnataka is struggling to find one startup which will solve the nutrition problem of the state. One startup which will solve the education problem of the state. One startup which will solve the healthcare problem of the state. Zero. The only startups they are getting is food delivery startups. The only startups they are getting are pizza delivery startups. The only startups they are getting are taxi services startups. But they are not getting any single startup from bright young people like you, which will solve the nutrition problem of the country, the education problem of the country, the healthcare problem, the three big problems of this country. You want to talk about the future? Here is your largest future opportunity. There are 1.2 billion people who need education, healthcare, nutrition. What other future do you want to talk about? The biggest existential crisis of human beings seems to be this, isn't it? So a couple of weeks back, two robots got talking in Japan. You know this story, right? Do you know this story? So one of the robots asked the other robot, artificial intelligence, early stage artificial intelligence robots. So one robot asked the other one, do you think there is something fundamentally wrong with robots taking over the world from human beings? So one robot asked the other robot, do you think there is something fundamentally wrong with robots taking over the world from human beings? Is it unethical? And the other robot says, look, there's nothing unethical about taking over from human beings, because to begin with, human beings themselves are not very unethical in nature. So to stealing from the thief, how can it be wrong? So these are early stage artificial intelligence systems. Facebook had to shut down its artificial intelligence system, right? That news you would have definitely read, because that's from last week. You know that news? Yeah. Because they started conversing in a new language. So the first thing they did was create a language for themselves. Now, human beings created language only 60,000 years ago. 62,000 years to be precise. Compared to them, these guys have done it in a year. So yes, this will fundamentally change the nature of the world. But then both Mr. Darwin and dear God decided that there's nothing which is permanent in this world. So why should human beings be any different? Enjoy your time in this planet, make the most of it, and don't worry about the time when you will not be the dominant species of the planet. Inevitable, it will happen. Big deal. The tigers never complained that they were going extinct, did they? So what are we complaining about now? Big data. How many of you have not heard of the word big data? Not heard big data. So 100% of the people in this room know what is big data, right? Now here is the fundamental confusion. Big data does not necessarily mean big information. And big information does not necessarily mean big insights. Because insights are different from information, are different from data. In fact, the bigger data becomes, the less information you get out of it. Because of the simple fact of data redundancy. Let's take about how many of you have traveled in aircrafts? Many of you, right? So you would have seen those airports, correct? So imagine security cameras in the airport. So I put 10 security cameras in my airport. So I get 10 information, right? 10 data. Then I put 10 more security cameras. Do I get 20 data? Yes, I get 20 data. But do I get 20 information? I don't get 20 information because they are going to capture the same faces. Maybe from a different angle and a different pose, but essentially the same faces. Now will I get, out of those 20 data points, will I get 20 insights? Will I get 20 insights? I won't. So the reality is the more data you gather, the less information you have, and even lesser the insights. Because let's not confuse data with information with insights. They're all different things. So you have this entire universe of big data that everybody is so kicked and gung-ho about. In this entire universe of big data, you have a small bubble which is called information. So data which is relevant and data which is not redundant. So relevant, non-redundant, manageable data becomes information. Now that information, a large part of that is actually noise. It is not relevant to us. Because it is irrelevant info. Like for example, I have 800 data points from this room which says that all of you were born in 1995, right? But there's actually only one information, that 80% of this room is composed of people called millennials, right? And now the question is, are millennials different from others? That is where the insights will come from. So data by itself is irrelevant. When data translates into insights, which is novel, unique information which I can use, that is when it becomes relevant. So don't get caught up in the data trap. Look for insights. Because insights is what is going to take you wherever you want to go. Not big data, or bigger data, or enormous data. Because the next problem is, in this connected world, we are going to be having enormous data. Think about a topic, right? Any topic. Facebook shut down artificial intelligence system. That's a topic. Now, how many people put it on their Facebook page? Hundreds of thousands of people. How many people tweeted about it? Hundreds of thousands of people. How many people actually forwarded that as a WhatsApp link? Hundreds of thousands of people. All of this is data. But where is the information? One single piece of information. Out of hundreds and thousands of pieces of data, there's only one piece of information. That two artificial intelligence systems started talking to each other in an unknown language, which is a risk to human beings, and hence it was shut down. And what is the insight of it, out of it? Even lesser, because you don't know actually what is the insight. Is the insight that we should not have AI systems, or is the insight that we should have protocols and rules and regulation for AI systems, the three laws of robotics? What should we have for AI systems? That insight is still not out of it, but the data is huge, humongous in fact. Everybody is talking about it. So that is the challenge. You, as you become connected and you have your Facebook profiles, your Instagram profiles, your LinkedIn pages, and you're part of groups, data will start replicating itself, duplicating itself. Just like we take backup of our computer systems, data will start getting backed up, and all of that data is a lot of noise, not really insights. So now that we have looked into some aspects of the future, let's look at some aspects of the past. Does history have a lesson for us? Can we learn from our past rather than learning from our concepts of a future? So let's look at history. 1962. Now that you knew the significance of 1995, what is the significance of 1962? War, okay. What else? What else? So 1962 was the year when everyone in the music industry said that bands with guitars are going out. So bands with guitars were no more the future of the world. So it was already too late for anyone to come up with a band with guitars. So if you had something like a Backstreet Boys in 1962, it would have failed. Because everybody was sure that is not the future. Unfortunately, these four boys thought differently. The Beatles. So in 1962, when guitars were not the future of the world, when bands with guitars were on the way out, the Beatles created a new cult. What was the song? What was the song? What was the song? What was the song? Love, love me do, you know I love you, I'll always be true, so love me do. So when India and China were talking about war, here were four boys talking about love. And they changed the world. So it doesn't matter if you are too late into the future. As long as you are committed to what you are doing, as long as you are sure about that is what you want to do, and as long as you are working hard enough to do it, you will succeed. Let's go back a little, even further down memory lane. 1903. Harley Davidson. Okay, what else? So guys, tell me one thing. You guys know nothing about your past and you want to talk about the future, is it? Tell me one thing. What happened in 1903? December 17 to be precise. two people with a cycle repair shop, no money, beat the US War Office to the first mechanical heavier-than-air flight. Two people with no money and a bicycle repair shop. When the US government had put its entire effort and $50,000 that day, 114 years back, $50,000 must be worth $5 million at least today. So the US government put $5 million on that job, 50,000 at that point in time, failed. And all of you have heard about the Wright brothers, but none of you have heard about Samuel Pierpont Langley. Have you heard of Samuel Pierpont Langley? So he was the gentleman who was given $50,000 to make man fly. So your privileges don't mean a thing. Your heart, right here, means everything. So how much you have here does not really matter. How much you have here is what will take you wherever you want to go. What? So tell me one thing. How many of you have read the poem Kublai Khan? Kublai Khan? Anyone from ICC schools? There is a poem called Kublai Khan, right? How many of you have heard of Genghis Khan? Lot of people, right? Now, tell me one thing, how do you know about these people? Who wrote the history? Who wrote the history? Who wrote the history? So in 1271, a 17-year-old Italian boy, Marco Polo, in the year 1271, a 17-year-old boy, Italian boy, Marco Polo, decided to, for the next 24 years, the same age when most of us are still busy with our video games and our crushes in college and our Facebook accounts and our WhatsApp groups, in the same age, this 17-year-old boy decided to, for the next 24 years, take this journey. And this boy told the world about Indian history, Chinese history, and a lot of what the world knows about any of us today. It's because of this one single boy who decided to forget about childhood crushes, forget about everything else, and do this. So at the age of 17, somebody does this. At the age of 23, somebody gets hanged for his conviction. My question to you guys is, at the age of 17 or at the age of 23, what exactly are you up to? Simple question. Food for thought. Tell me. You are talking about the future, right? You have a 500 rupee coin in your pocket? 500 rupee note in your pocket? Anyone? Take it out. Take it out. Take it out. अब जो उसके ऊपर है ना 2263 साल पुराना और 2280 साल पुराना उसको नमस्कार करो बिकॉज द फ्यूचर समटाइम्स इज दैट ओल्ड. इंटरेस्टिंगली अ लॉट ऑफ पीपल मे नॉट नो दिस एंड दिस इज कॉन्ट्रोवर्शियल नो वे ऑफ प्रूविंग दिस But a lot of people say that the Star of David in Christianity comes from this very symbol here. So a lot of what we talk about the future actually happens in the deeds of the past. How many of you think that mentorship, coaching are all contemporary modern concepts? No, we talk about mentorship, competencies, coaching. How many of you have heard the word competencies? Mentorship, coaching. Hey, they're all management subjects, isn't it? Management subjects of 2017? Yeah? Sorry? So competencies is being taught to us for the last 30 years, isn't it? In the Mahabharata. How much time do I have, by the way? Half an hour? Great. More than that? Even better. So we talk about a lot of these concepts and say that it sounds like modern concepts, right? For example, competencies. What are competencies, by the way? Attitude, skill, knowledge, right? Rote learning, we have all learned. Attitude, skill, knowledge. Now let me tell you an interesting thing. What is the difference between Arjuna and Karna in the Mahabharata? What is the difference? Sorry? Of course, that is part of it. Arjuna had a good mentor, but there is something fundamentally different between the two of them, right? What is that? Okay, so if you read the Mahabharata, there is a concept there called. So they talk about in one of the episodes they talk about the difference between these two, and the difference is so basically one god is talking to another god, and they say that look, there is something called Shakti, there is something called Samarth, there is something called Shaurya. Okay, Shakti, Samarth, and Shaurya. And they said that, look, in terms of Shakti and Samarthya, which means knowledge and skill, both of them are similar people. But it is Shaurya, their attitude towards life, their sense of integrity and ethics, which actually divides the two people and separates them. So while on one episode, Arjun says that I absolutely cannot take up weapons against my own people, in another episode, Karna finds no problem in diverting his arrow towards an unborn child. So competencies were being spoken about even then. And in 400 BC, when they wrote the Bhagavad Gita, they spoke about mentorship, coaching, how that all of us need a coach or a guide or a mentor at some point in time. Let's go back a little further. What? So, ladies and gentlemen, my submission to you is this is the start of digital. This is called the Mesopotamian abacus. 4,000 years back. Can't hear you. One person, tell me. One person, stand up. Tell me, one person, what is this year known for? Okay, forget that. How many of you have heard of Budweiser? Bira? Foster's? Kingfisher Strong? Miller High Life? That was the year when beer was born. And this, ladies and gentlemen, is the officially recorded first recipe, 3,000 year old, again Mesopotamia, of how to make beer. Tell me. If this year had not happened, we will not be having this conversation today. Sorry? Tell me. One person, raise your hand. Tell me, what is this? Who is that? Stand up. Tell the world. Tell them what they don't know. Tell them. Language. Okay? So human beings learned the art of language 60,000 years ago, and ever since then, whether it is WhatsApp or Facebook or Snapchat or whatever else, is the consequences of that day. So your future is sometimes extremely difficult to imagine, but what is possible to do is fix your present. Those two standing there and having this conversation, they didn't know Facebook. They didn't know that WhatsApp is going to happen. They didn't care whether your phone will speak to your refrigerator or not. All they cared about was making the other understand what one was trying to say. So the question is, Half an hour into this session, what is it that we are saying in this room? Aap aur hum, aaj kya baatein kar rahe hain? what are we talking about? Don't hide behind the crowd, raise your hand and tell me exactly what you feel. Seize the moment. About evolution? Okay, how time changes? And what is the most important part about evolution? So the most important part about evolution is actually that moment when 3% genes changed shape and monkeys turned into human beings. You know the difference between a gorilla and a human being? 3%. In fact, the difference between a banana and a human being? Do you know? Genetically, the difference between a banana and a human being is also less than 10%. So that funny point in time, when that difference happens, is the important point. I'm not saying that the trends are not real. Of course, some of the trends are real, extremely real. It is a fact that today the world is undergoing what I call dominofication. You know what is dominofication? You know what is dominofication? You have seen, have you ordered pizza or burger or anything else online? So there's a tracker which moves, which means at any point in time, it is exactly precisely possible to track the movement of anything in this world today, be it a human being or a pizza. That is real. The fact that we are all connected is real. It is a fact that some jobs will go away tomorrow. It is a fact that the government of India is already talking about from a liberalization era of 1991 to a restrictive era of 2017 when they said we will not allow driverless technology to enter this country. Isn't that what the transport minister said? Right? The same thing that they were saying 20 years, 30 years, 40 years back. We will not allow a Domino's pizza to enter this country. We will not allow single brand retail to enter this country. We will not allow 100% foreign direct investment in airlines. We will not allow 100% foreign investment in single brand retail. We have allowed all of that. So today if we are saying we will not allow driverless technology, we are lying. We will. We just don't know it yet. So yes, there are certain things happening in this world which are extremely real, and they are going to change the shape of the world. But the funny part is that has been true every single year since human existence. That is not something which is happening today. That is not something which is happening in the future. All of that is happening actually in the past. So all the technologies which will come together to make the driverless car possible are all technologies of the past. It is just that we are bringing them all together. And yes, it is a fact that you cannot hope to have a career. In the near future, you need to have skills. So you must move away from career ladders into skill ladders. So if your skill needed today is negotiation, you must negotiate. If the skill needed tomorrow is collaboration, you must collaborate. If the skill needed day after tomorrow is individual excellence, you must excel individually. So the careers of the future, which is actually, as soon as you can predict, it's no more the future, right? It's the present. So the careers of the present are skill-based. They are not career. You cannot decide one fine day, I want to be a marketing guy. What exactly does it mean? I'm an HR guy, right? What am I doing today? Marketing. I'm trying to convince 1,000 people that my company is good enough to join. I'm trying to convince 1,000 people that I am good enough to work with, that's marketing. But I studied HR. So tomorrow, You cannot hide behind one specialization, say I'm a specialist. You know, surgeons, what is a surgeon today? Today a surgeon is an elevated computer technician. Today a surgeon is an elevated computer technician. His job is to make sure that the robotic arm that he uses to do a surgery works exactly the way he wants it to work. But for that, he must know how it works. Today, a pilot is an elevated computer technician. Today, even a sailor is an elevated computer technician. So things are changing. Now, today, an HR guy is not an elevated computer technician, but trust me, tomorrow he will be. So yes, some changes are real, some changes are happening, some changes will change the way the future is going to be, but do not fall for the hoopla. Do not fall for the hoopla. A lot of the world will continue to be run exactly the same manner it has been run for the last 60,000 years. And what is that exactly? What is that exactly? So that actually consists of some very simple thing. Simplify. Go back to the basics. A teacher's job is teaching, a student's job is learning. Now let's look at some examples of that. For the B schools in general, because we are talking about challenges for the B schools, not just challenges for the B school students. So let's look at the B school. So is the B school a theater or is it an echo chamber? Is the B school giving us moments of a journey from the moment the hero and the heroine find it impossible to make their story a success to the moment they actually succeed? Is the B school taking you through that journey? There is a reason why I call my campus to corporate masterclasses as the hero's journey. Because if you look at the reality of the world, all of us live that life where, no, at first you refuse to take a journey, then somebody convinces you to take a journey, then you find enough temptations and roadblocks and traps in your journey, then somebody walks in as a mentor and helps you address those roadblocks, those temptations, and you finally succeed till you take the next journey. So your teachers are like that, your B schools are like that. So is it an echo chamber where your notes don't change year after year? Or is it a theater where this moment, today's class, today's lecture is very, very different from yesterday's lecture, because today is very, very different from yesterday? What is the B school about? That is the first question. 1,000 Weeks of Romance doesn't work anymore. A movie's future today is decided over a weekend, isn't it? In a weekend, you decide whether it is worthwhile to go and see Shah Rukh Khan make a fool of himself or not. That his latest movie, its life was decided over one weekend, right? One weekend, people tend to decide to trash it, and it was trashed. So today, 1,000 Weeks of Romance cannot happen. Today, it is the world of instant media. Social influence. In today's world, you cannot afford even to walk into that classroom with the same set of notes which you walked into the classroom for the last batch. It doesn't work. Let's look at beyond business. The Supreme Court in 2014, actually originally 1991, but in 2014 said that all universities must include environmental studies in their curriculum. Original judgment 1991, a curative petition in 2014. As we stand today, 300 plus universities still need to include environmental studies in their curriculum. Status of ethics, corporate governance, and environment education. ethics was offered by 65% B schools, corporate governance by 32%, and CSR by 10%, environmental sustainability by 14%. And these are the same B schools, 100% of whom have social citizenship as part of their vision statement. All of them. In fact, I'll take some examples here in the next slide. I'm Ahmedabad. Society at large and social progress. XLRI, common good and a sustainable future. XIMB, personal values and social concern. Your college, enablers of tomorrow's world. Now the question is, what part of your curriculum is taking care of this? Say an unknown quote. Here's an unknown quote. I don't know who is the say. When we imagine the future worlds and create vision, by acting on that vision, we set in motion circumstances that enable our imagination to become a reality. So my submission to everyone, not just B schools, corporates, individuals, you want to have a vision? Please have a realistic vision. Say what you are actually going to do. Otherwise, don't say it. Nothing wrong. Have a vision. My vision is to create future leaders who will all look for fat salaries. Great. My vision is to ensure that the day I pass out, my students must start thinking about, I will be a team leader. I will run a team of 100 people. Or say that I am going to enable tomorrow. And if you are going to be enabling tomorrow, then you are supposed to be doing something about it today, isn't it? So go back, look at your vision statement. And this submission is not to your college, this submission is to you guys as individuals. Either you must buy into that vision and make it possible, or stop being hypocrites. Either you must buy into that vision and make it possible, stop being hypocrites. For you guys, okay? Simple. You want to talk about the future? 3 or 4 simple things to be done. That's it. I heard you guys work 365 days in a year, isn't it? Yes. You work 365 days in a year, you make a lot of effort to actually call some 17, 18 speakers to come and talk to you, hopefully some sense, and then half of you actually are outside, busy with flowers and cameras and a lot of extended welcome and not enough time spent in this room. How does that work? I didn't come here to receive flowers from you guys. Sorry. I came here to make sure that whatever I learned in 15 years, at least some part of it goes into 1,000 excited, future-ready people, isn't it? And if I miss 5 of them, I'm worried. Quick welcome, 1 minute. Then you should stop caring about me till I enter this room. I don't want your coffee. I can get my own coffee. I want your attention. Can you give me that? So think about your action and your vision. And if your vision and your actions don't talk to each other, either change your action or change your vision. I'm not saying which one you should change. That is up to you. But you must push yourself. I don't know how many of you watched this. Which test match? India versus West Indies. Antigua. So the previous night, Anil Kumble was hit with a ball on his chin and broke his chin. They didn't realize it till that morning. So last evening, there was an X-ray, nothing was found, but he was still in terrible pain. So the next morning, they still did another X-ray, and they discovered that the lower jaw and the upper jaw are completely separated from each other. Gone. So this area is completely broken. After that, because that test match was in its last day, and he still wanted to win it, he bowled, and he bowled, and he bowled, and he bowled, and he bowled. And the best West Indian wicket, Ryan Lara, was in his bag. We didn't win it, that's a different issue. Win and loss is in a lot of other functions, right? It's not just he's bowling, the West Indians are also batting, right? And they have an equally strong vision about themselves. So win and lose, not in his control. The effort was 100% in his control. Push yourself. That's the first part. The second part is slightly different from that. There will be times when you will feel, why are you doing this? Why are you doing this? That is the time when you must say, look, I must keep the fire going. Because the more difficult the time is, the more it requires your support, doesn't it? So here is a little concept I'm working on. This is something which I call the effort reward matrix. This is what I call the, so far, no heavy stuff, I hope. So this is slightly heavier. This is what I call the effort reward matrix. If your effort is low and your rewards are low, don't be surprised, it is because of poor performance. If your efforts are mediocre, medium, and your rewards are low, still poor performance because you haven't really tried hard enough. If your efforts are high but your rewards are low, you either made a bad choice or you had bad luck. If your efforts are low and your rewards are medium, then you're not chasing high enough. Your goals are too low. You're only chasing low-hanging fruits. If your efforts are medium and your rewards are medium, you are an average performer. If your efforts are high and your rewards are medium, you're on stretch assignments. Tough luck. That's how the world is. If your efforts are low and your rewards are high, it's because of chance. Non-sustainable performance. It won't happen again next year or next moment. If your efforts are medium and your rewards are high, again, you are pushing yourself, but you're not pushing yourself hard enough. And if your efforts are high and your rewards are high, congratulations. Because you belong to that minority of people who take a vision and carry it on their shoulders irrespective of external circumstances. These are the people who change the world. These are the people that who change the world. Choice is actually yours. You know, 80% of the world is mediocre. We come, we get up in the morning, we go to work, we come back, whatever we earned in the day, we spend during the night, we do the same thing again next morning. 80% of us are like that. Then there are the other 20% who are called Martin Luther King, and Nelson Mandela, and Mahatma Gandhi, and Mark Zuckerberg, or anybody else whom you admire. I don't know where you want to be. Your 20% is sitting in that corner on the top. I hope you want to sit in that corner on the top. Another big challenge of human beings, you know. We are essentially pack animals, right? We are essentially pack animals. Try living alone for more than 3 days at a stretch. So essentially we are pack animals, but imagine what we are taught from pre-KG onwards. Stars for individual brilliance, ranks for individual brilliance, gold medals for individual brilliance. Competing against our fellow human being. And we keep doing it for 19 years. We keep doing it for 19 years, and then one fine day we enter an organization and we are expected to change all that behavior of 19 years and become collaborators. So suddenly, you join somewhere as a management trainee and you are said, look, it is all about teamwork. Hello, you never told me this for 19 years. In fact, the world is being run wrongly. The entire world is being managed wrongly. A bowler bowls, a fielder catches, still the wicket goes in the name of the bowler. But if the fielder drops, then the drop goes in the name of the fielder. Why not the drop is going in the name of the bowler? What happens when all the other 10 batsmen get out on the other end? Can a batsman hit a century? Highly unlikely. So it is all about... What is this? I hope the sound is working.
I did what I did for the good of the realm.
The
realm. Do you know what the realm is? It's the thousand blades of Aegon's enemies. A story we agree to tell each other over and over till we forget that it's a lie.
But what do we have left once we abandon the lie? Chaos. A gaping pit waiting to swallow us all.
Chaos isn't a pit. Chaos is a ladder. Many who try to climb it fail, never get to try again. The fall breaks them. And some are given a chance to climb, but they refuse. They cling to the realm, or the gods, or love. Illusions. Only the ladder is real. The climb is all there is.
So, I'm not going to take you through further slides. There are two more slides which I don't want to, we can talk about it some other day. But chaos. Chaos is a ladder. So what are you worried about? Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
A leader is the one who knows the way, goes the way, and shows the way. Good afternoon to one and all. I, Ayushi Rodeja, student manager of Sri Balaji Society, would like to express our sincere thanks to Mr. Prabhash Nirbhay, sir. Thank you, sir, for sparing your valuable time to guide us for a successful career. Future, if you predict it, it has already arrived. Things are simple. We make it complicated. We are all inspired by your great words. Finally, I would like to thank our beloved Bala sir for his guidance and providing us such a stimulating and learning environment. Thank you.
Thank you, Ayushi.